Please welcome NASIO Executive Committee Member Dennis Goulet to the stage.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me.
Well, good morning, NASIO. I'm Dennis Goulet, the Commissioner of the Department of Information Technology for the state of New Hampshire. I'm also the person that didn't get the memo about the bow ties, so I'm wearing the one my wife picked out for me, so I hope that's okay. I'm also a member of the NASIO Executive Committee and serve as the Awards Committee co-chair. In the 2018 State CIO Survey, which NASIO conducts with Grant Thornton and CompTIA, CIOs were asked which characteristic was most important to their success. In the top 10 answers, technologists ranked number 9, and the top 3 answers were communicator, relationship manager, and strategist. Though the stereotype of CIOs may be one of working with boxes and wires, the reality is one of working with people. Yesterday's keynote speaker, Tim Sanders, really set the table for this discussion. This next session will focus on the non-technical essential traits that are common among some of our extraordinary CIOs. 3 of the 5 CIOs interviewed for a joint publication between the Center for Digital Government and Deloitte will share traits they've found to help them be successful. Terry Takai, the Executive Director for the Center for Digital Government, will moderate. Terry certainly knows a thing or two about being a successful CIO. She's the former CIO for both the state of Michigan and the state of California. Terry is also past president of NASIO. She will be joined by Josh Nisbet of Deloitte, who worked with her on this project. In celebration of NASIO's 50th anniversary, we've been celebrating the history of our members as well. We asked the CIOs what they were doing the year of some of NASIO's milestones. As I introduce the CIO panel, I'd like to share a few of those answers. In 1972, NASIO was officially incorporated. Also in 72, Craig Orgeron, CIO for Mississippi and past president of NASIO, was self-reportedly crushing it in pre-K. We have no doubt that Craig has always been crushing it. In 1989, the association changed its name from National Association for State Information Systems to the National Association of State Information Resource Executives. A pithy one. Also in 89, Dewan Neely, CIO for Indiana, a NASIO Executive Committee member, was in 6th grade preparing for the career he knew was his future. How'd that work for you, Dewan? That of an NBA basketball star. At some point, Dewan changed his mind on his career path, and in 2001, he was finishing up his last semester in Purdue University. Dewan kindly shared a picture of himself in that time period. Nice. In 2001, the association's name was changed to the current NASIO. Also in 2001, Mike Hussey, CIO for Utah, was working in the Utah Governor's Office preparing for the Winter Olympics. I would imagine Mike could do a separate session on the leadership lessons learned from that experience. Please welcome Terry, Craig, Mike, Dewan, and Josh to the stage.
All right, we're gonna be really excited. Is everybody excited? All right, come on, let's give it up for my team here. All right, before I sit down, I have to just tell you a funny story. So since we're doing NASIO stories, I have to tell you my funny story. So some of you may remember, as Doug illustriously remembers, the year that I was president of NASIO. First of all, you all need to know that I drove him absolutely nuts. I would call him every week and ask him what was going on. But the most fun thing, if those of you remember the two conferences that year, okay? When we get to the mid-year conference, I got sick on the plane getting to NASIO. I went to my room, was sick for a day, and then went home. But it gets better. At the annual conference, my governor shut down government because of the budget, and so I had to leave, and I wasn't here to moderate either. So both times, remember John Gillespie? Do you guys remember John Gillespie? God yeah. love him. Not the world's most extroverted guy, right? He had to step in and actually be my stand-in for that. So Dennis, I know how that feels. That's great that you could relieve John. You could relieve James. So anyway, that's my funny NASIO story. Okay, so I'm going to move over
here so that the guy with the mics doesn't go nuts, right? So, you know, one of the things that we talked about, and I think Dennis mentioned it when we were starting today, is I think that today was actually a really great setup for this session. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited that these guys agreed to sort of be volunteers, right?
Mostly.
All right.
Voluntold.
Yeah, exactly. Voluntold. And, you know, we talked about the innovation session that everybody started with, really talked about, and Tim talked about collaboration and innovation, and that innovation was really a matter of the team and actually being able to draw from the diversity of the team and the thinking of the team. And then I think the last session around CIO's broker was really great because it talked about the kind of things, kind of started to touch on the things that we're gonna talk about. But what it didn't really talk about is how we as individuals all have different strengths. We all have different ways that we go at issues, but you know, sometimes I think we sort of think maybe we're born with it or we're not born with it, and actually that's not true. You know, I tell people if you went to my Myers-Briggs, I am an introvert.
Yay, you do.
Guys, laughs, come on, come on, this is audience participation. And you know, people kind of go, well, that's, you know, doesn't seem like that, but it's really about kind of understanding what those traits are and then being able to understand how you actually either look at those you're good at, look at those maybe you're not so good at, and think about how to really develop those. Last thought I want to leave before I turn it over to my partner in crime, Josh, is that while we talked about this, and as Josh and I were thinking about this idea, we thought about it as it relates to the CIOs. But I'd like each of you in the room, and at some point we're gonna go to an audience participation question, I'd like you all to think about how this isn't just about, as a CIO, what are the skills, what are the traits and the kind of approaches that you use, but I would suggest that it actually applies to everyone in the room. Because again, number one, you're going to need to adapt to the various styles of the individuals here that are your customers. But also, it's about just relationships and effectively how you build something that Eric talked about that I think the team here is going to talk about, and that is the essential element in government of trust. And actually, how do you build those personal relationships that create and make those things into trusted relationships? So Josh, I know you and I have been talking about this for some time. I think it took us, a lot longer than we thought it was gonna take us. Because it's, I think, something that people are uncomfortable with talking about. It's kind of that soft skill thing. Yeah. Everybody kind of goes, right? I don't want to really talk about that. And so that's why I think Josh was great, because he kind of thought about it and talked about it as traits.
Exactly.
As opposed to kind of those other mushy words that make people kind of nervous. And I think that if we could get the slide that's got the five traits on it, whoever's controlling the slides, we could do that.
There we go.
Okay. Because this is the backdrop. And so I think the other thing, Josh, that you tried to do and you were really helpful with is to try to express this in kind of five phrases that didn't get into that kind of quote mushy stuff.
Right.
Right?
Exactly.
That things that were kind of areas that people could relate to in terms of thinking about themselves. So maybe you could just talk about, you know, what are you, how did you come to that?
Yeah.
What are you seeing in CIOs that is really making them successful? You know, like the three guys we have here with us.
Absolutely, thanks, Terry. The role of the CIO to me fascinates me. And for some of the same reasons that I think all of our organizations and each of your roles fascinate me. Many of us are put in situations where we are asked to lead, but we may not own all the resources that we're asked to lead. Or we are asked to develop a vision and head in a direction where we don't necessarily have the armies of individuals or the resources at their command that we're able to direct. We may be asked, a CIO may be asked to innovate or modernize, whether it be a procurement approach or a solution. And there is some type of acknowledgement that that there's gonna be some salesmanship involved. There's gonna be some integration involved. There's gonna be accessing some traits, and the ones that we're gonna talk about today, that will require integration, a coalition of the willing to be created. We are only successful when we tap into the resources and bring people along with us. And as we started to interview several CIOs, some of whom are on the stage today, across the country, we found that there was commonality in some of the strengths that they employed day to day, that you used every day, that helped them to build these teams. And the exciting thing, what I hope that the audience today will do, is only a portion of you are state CIOs. Some might be aspiring CIOs. Some might be partners or teammates to these leaders. And I think that the traits that we talk about today have direct and personal application to each of us as we create energy and inertia around moving forward a vision. So as we identified some common themes as we started to have these interviews, what had occurred to us was that in this period of transition where we've had, you know, many gubernatorial changes, many administration changes, and certainly we welcome new members to this esteemed group, that we could provide not only kind of a few thoughts around leadership 101, but create some strengths and some approaches to these integration skills that we've identified. So it's interesting too, and I hope that the audience, as we talk through these five today, and we're gonna have an opportunity to ask some questions and interact, look for commonality, because I've found that there's actually a thread or two that that permeates each of these five traits and that weaves them, that ties them together to where, whether it's one of the three of you or also a couple of other, we had not seated with us today, Bob Sampson from New York, Morgan Reed from Arizona, were also a part of this this paper. And so the threads, I think, that were brought up by each of you, I think will become pretty apparent as we go today.
Great, well thanks, yeah. Josh. Yeah, so what I'd like to start with is an audience response question. And what I'd like each of you to think about is, which of these skills do you think that you're the best at? Do you think you're good at reading, listening? Do you think you're good at bringing people together from an integrative skill standpoint? How's your political savvy? How do you do at reading the room? How are you at really kind of the underlying piece of innovation, which is curiosity? And then lastly, to the point around leadership, how do you, to Josh's point, how do you bring people together who actually may not like what you're trying to do and get them to actually come to your point of view or to come to a consensus? So if you could take a minute, and which trait do you feel comes easiest to you?
I think you people have proven something to the world, that a half a million kids can get together and have 3 days of fun and music.
Doug, who picked
the
music,
you go.
Man?
That was amazing.
Nice job.
Josh, was that your band?
That wasn't my band.
Okay, got it. Huh. Okay.
Interesting.
Emotional intelligence.
Oof. All right.
Fantastic.
Interesting. Well, Mike, I mean, let me turn to you. If you were to say which trait actually comes easiest to you, which trait would you pick?
I selected Relentless Curiosity. I think that is just me personally. I mean, you talked about some of those things that whether or not they're innate or learned, I think that's something that's been innate in me ever since growing up, tearing apart, you know, alarm clocks or whatever, just to figure out what makes them tick, so to speak. So I think that was one of the easier ones that came to me, and it's proved very lucrative as we've looked at how to push things in Utah and how to stretch ourselves. And so for me, Relentless Curiosity is part of me, and it's really how to teach that in the organization. So we've been trying to, hey, let's be a little more curious. As a matter of fact, something I've learned recently, I think it is a great trait that kind of weaves through a lot of different aspects. And I understand that Amazon was going to be called Relentless early on. And as a matter of fact, Jeff Bezos first thought he would name Amazon Relentless. And so I think of that. As a matter of fact, if you go to relentless.com, it will take you to amazon.com. So if you ever want to experiment a little bit and look at that domain. But this is where I feel like you need to be very curious, but yet very persistent at being curious and pushing those the envelope, so to speak, of where you think things can go, and then how to get there is the challenging part. But that's another story.
So how does your team react?
And that's,
you know, when you say, "Wow, why don't we go and do this?"
That's the amazing thing. I mean, I think there's so many people that would rather look at changing their job more frequently or changing what they're doing day to day. They don't want to get in these traditional things, these habits of just the mundane. And so being curious gives them an opportunity to explore with you. And so you just provide those guardrails and say, hey, let's look at something in this space. And I think all of a sudden you get this momentum in as an agency, you get this momentum as a group, and you start to find opportunities that you didn't know existed. And that brings, once you find those successes, all of a sudden everybody else coming in say, oh wait, I want to be successful, I want to do something like that. And as long as they know those boundaries, they're excited to be part of that movement. And I see the energy that comes from that, I see the excitement, and I see the actually the recruitment and retention kind of helps out as well. So that excitement that can kind of permeate the agency really does bring about a lot of success just on its own.
Well, I think it comes back to the collaboration point as well, right? We were talking about innovation and collaboration and actually being able to do that collectively rather than it being kind of just, this is Mike's idea, why are we doing this,
right? Yeah.
Mike, there was a point that you made several times when we talked to you about this paper. You kept using the phrase, lift your gaze.
Lift your gaze.
Lift your gaze. Could you talk a little bit about what it means in the context of Relentless Curiosity to lift your gaze?
Absolutely.
And then how might you instill that as a part of the culture of your organization?
So, and if I can use a Game of Thrones example, I hope that's okay, Meredith.
Hey, as long as there are no
spoilers.
We're going a couple weeks ago. Tyrion was down in the crypt as the big battle was ensuing, and he was saying, hey, if I can get up there and I can maybe provide a different perspective or see what's going on, I might be able to help. And I think that's what a lot of times, you know, we get so heads down on what we're just working on. We're looking at one particular thing. We're just so focused on this that we're not seeing the art of possible.
Right.
And so to come in with a fresh perspective and offer that to kind of really look at the horizon, it really does probably push the limits of really what you're focused on if you're two heads down.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was saying lift your gaze, look at the art of possible, look at really what is the problem you're trying to solve, and is really what I'm doing here going to get me there? If you're looking at the bigger picture, let's change childhood obesity in the state of Utah. Let's change some big thing, and all of a sudden you get that momentum rather than, well, I'm just going to write these few lines of code, and I'm not sure really what the end goal is. So by lifting your gaze and looking at the future and the art of possible, I think really helps.
What do you do to coach your team to do likewise?
That's a challenge. And a lot of times, like this award that the governor received today, when I say, hey, look at the great things that you're doing. I mean, really, that the governor kind of couched that perfectly when he said, you know, there's a lot of staff that really get recognized because of their efforts. So I want to go in and say, hey, look, guys, this is really the exciting part of this. We're not just coding this particular application. we're doing some things for the state of Utah. We're doing things for its citizens. And so as we go back, I remodeled our lobby just so I could put some of these kinds of awards out to show our staff that some of the great things they're doing that really would help them lift their gaze.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you know, we talked about, Josh mentioned the fact that none of you operate just in your leadership role with your teams. Mm-hmm. You operate in an environment that is enormously complex and getting even more complex as you try in your role, in the broker role, to try to have legislators understand what you're doing, you know, really try to get your agency leads to understand what that means. So, Dawn, you talked about political savvy as being really critical. And, you know, you came in from the private sector, so maybe you can just talk about, you know, how did you actually make your way? You know, what has that really meant for you and all the success you've had in Indiana?
Yeah, political savvy, and you know, the definition I read that as, and you heard Eric reference it several times in the previous session, is having a seat at the table and making sure the state views you as not just the IT guy. You're a leader of a technology organization, and you're there to you know, impart change, transformation, and help the state deliver services the best it can. And sometimes it's tough to break out of that mold, especially a person like myself. I come from a strong IT background, not really a business side. And so I take extra care, pay extra attention to not appear to be heavy technical in those areas, because those are the people that you need to move the things at a high level, the legislatures, the cabinet, the agency leadership. And they don't speak that talk. I learned that really early. And one of the things that frustrates me the most, and this happens several times, is you schedule a meeting with that agency leader because you want to talk about some really important things. And he brings his IT guy. He brings his agency CIO. And I was like, that's not what I was going for. So after that happens a couple times, you know, you try different tactics. And so there's several agency leaders where I've just reached out and said, hey, can I buy you lunch? Let's just go have lunch, and it's on me. Let's go chat. And I keep that conversation focused really on them. I just listen, let them talk, talk about family, talk about you know, activities outside of work, and just share broad level. What are you struggling with from an agency leadership perspective? How are your people? How's your recruiting? Those types of things, and kind of establish that rapport. And that kind of goes back to what we talked about earlier too, getting that trust. And you really to go in there with no agenda in those few initial meetings to gain that trust. And then after a while, you know, they're reaching out to you more, maybe they're texting you more. And, you know, I see success. For an example, the particular agency head that I was really trying to break through on and get one-on-one with him without his IT guy. We did the lunch thing several times, but after a few months, he finally gave me a call one day and said, hey, Dawn, I could really use your help. I'm struggling with this thing here. I just don't know what to do. What are your thoughts? And that's like, I was like,
that's
yes.
That's a win. That's an absolute win.
I got him. And then so that, you know, that's going to lead to much more productive interactions down the road when it comes to me wanting to impart some major change, or when they're wanting to make major change in their agency. I need to get them aligned with what we're doing here. That's going to make those conversations much easier. You can't just wait until that situation arises to then try to persuade them to do it your way, because it's just not going to work.
Yeah. How does that work with, in terms of working with the governor's staff? You mentioned the governor's staff, because I think sometimes mm-hmm. we think, you know, that you guys just kind of talk to the governors, but half the time it's actually getting to the policy folks that advise the governor in order to be able to be effective. So how have you really worked with the governor's staff to actually make that happen?
Yeah, I think it's just communication and early and often on some of those things, and giving them a heads up as well. I try to be out of in front of them, knowing that hey, they may get some questions or they may get some feedback outside of me from some other agencies on this particular issue, and so I try to give them a heads up and say, hey, just FYI, here's some broader things we're doing from a state standpoint. You're probably going to get some pushback. You're probably going to get some questions along these lines. Here's some answers for you, some quick points for you to respond with on why we need to do this. And usually that'll trigger a meeting or trigger a call where I can kind of fill them in more and kind of fill in the blanks on that. And then, you know, depending on agencies' setups, you know, that my state's changed several times under Governor Pence. I was actually on the cabinet and sat in those cabinet meetings under current Governor Holcomb. I come through our Office of Management and Budget. And so I make sure my OMB director then has kind of the main points and is representing my agency in those cabinet meetings. And it's, you know, this is maybe a little bit manipulative, but on certain topics, I try to make it so that, hey, it's probably better if I'm there with you to kind of cover this topic. And that's a way to get him to bring me occasionally to talk about certain important key items that we want to get done so that I can have a face there and they know who I am and have a voice. Just, you know, not every day, not every meeting, but on the occasional ones, just so they can feel my presence.
One of the principles I think that Juwan is expressing here or implying is to take the time to understand the mindset of those with whom you're working. That is absolutely something that threaded its way through all of the traits and the principles that we talked about. And what do I mean by that? I mean, as you're thinking about how you would approach a discussion or an interaction to try and understand the mindset and then bring them about to your vision, try to identify. Are they a guardian of sorts? Are they interested in the rules and how it's always been done, and to make sure that we're on solid ground moving forward? Are they more interested in what's next? What's the next innovative step that we can take together? Is that the thing that energizes them? Are they more interested in making sure that there's consensus, that we all come together and that we all move together? Or are they thinking about what's next? How do we move there? Where do we go? As we take the time to understand the mindset of the people that we're working with, and then approach our message to them or with them in such a way that we bring them along. Mm-hmm. Now, he's talking about it with political savvy, but that is actually an important thing, I think, that threads and permeates each of the traits that we've talked about up here today and that we'll continue to discuss.
Yeah, so, another thing that Juwan said I think that's really important is that it feels a little sneaky maybe at times, but
sneaky?
That ability to get ahead of what might be differing opinions, if I can call it that, mm-hmm. and giving that heads up to the governor's office so that they're hearing it from you and not from the agency head, you know, I can't stress how important that is. It's not that you're really going around anyone, but it's really to say, hey, you're going to hear this. I'd like you to hear and know kind of what the other side of the discussion is before it gets to you. Because I think we all know that sometimes governor's offices can kind of whoop up fairly
Having
quickly.
Having those delicate conversations, that's
exactly.
part of being a seat at the table, right?
Exactly.
That's being a seat at the table.
Exactly. But I want to go from what you just said, Josh, to really, because I think Craig talked a lot about what it takes to do what you were just talking about. And I think, Craig, you were talking about not only kind of how you do that relationship, but I also like you to talk about kind of the, you know, your concept, back to what Juwan was saying, about needing to think about it for the long term.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because again, I always used to say, you got to be kind of careful because you never know who the governor went to high school with. Or, you know, so you got to be really careful about who your friends are and who you say about what. And it's really about that. You never know who inside the governor's cabinet is going to be the next governor, right?
Yeah.
So, Craig, maybe you can talk about just, you know, some of the things that you've known are really important.
Well, you know, from the emotional intelligence perspective, the thing that I've really focused on is self-awareness. And maybe in more modern lingo, it would be sort of mindfulness. Because there's an approach that's mindful that kind of calms you down on the inside. I think when you have these jobs, you're always the person that needs to answer the questions. And the thing I found was, when you're always a person that's answering the questions, and Eric touched on it earlier, you're not listening all that well.
Yeah.
And that's a bad place to be. You know, we had a midnight negotiation a couple of years ago. And we had a bill that was very important to us. Literally, it was midnight at the Capitol. And there was a gentleman that was trying to scuttle our bill. And of course, you know, so I went to talk to him, which is what I do. And I was talking and talking and talking and talking, and nothing really seemed to do anything. And he wandered off, and I turned to my Michelle, who was with me, and I said, what was he not? I mean, what? And she just looked at me and deadpanned. He doesn't really hear that good, Greg. So the point there wasn't to acknowledge it. The point was it really hit me in the face. I was consumed with telling and not letting him tell. One of many examples where you get caught up in the moment. But what really struck me about self-awareness is, some of the more recent things that I've read, not technical books. I think behavioral economics is fascinating. So from Michael Lewis's Undoing Project, Kahneman and Tversky, and the heuristics of how we think, and I think self-awareness really plays into that. Right? How is that other person thinking? What are they bringing to the table? Can I put my stuff down long enough to hear, to soak it in, to understand it? And there's a lot of, I think, kind of great material out there. Dan Ariely in North Carolina is doing some really good writing about those kind of things. I think those things are so important to understand how those decisions get made. And I think that's the more you pay attention to that, if you can find a way, and it's hard in our jobs to quiet down what's on the inside the best you can, most of it blossoms fairly naturally. It's sort of right there in front of you. If you're not consumed with, like I've been many times, like I've got to say this thing. I mean, I've really got to say this thing. And minus not being able to hear, I really need you to hear what I'm saying. I don't think that's an easy skill. Yeah. It certainly doesn't, we talked about innate skill. It does not come naturally. Yeah. I mean, I think it's something that you have to work on a whole lot.
Well, and I think it's also related to what Josh was saying about, it's not only listening, but also trying to understand what lens the other person is coming from in doing that. But I think you also, Craig, when we talked about this, just talked about this concept of the long game and not being distracted by today's issue, but kind of thinking into what that means longer term. And really, I'd like you to speak to it, but I'd like the other guys to speak to it as well.
So tough in today's world, so tough. Tenures for state CEOs are not what they should be. I don't think.
Yeah, where's Calvin? Calvin's an anomaly.
Yeah,
there he
Calvin.
Is.
Somebody had to help him raise his arm.
So I kind of almost view it as blended, right? I mean, many times you come in with a governor, there is a burn down the house agenda, as it should be. They're the elected person, they want to do great things. I think the dilemma, and this isn't always true, but I think the dilemma could be that maybe that strategy leaves, bodies on the side of the road, right? The longer term strategy, I think, tends to be relationship building, more nurturing. Is that a word CIOs say? I'm not sure. But
that's a good word.
In all seriousness, it's hard to blend the two. But if there's a way that you can, short-term goals with those long-term softer skills, it's a sweet spot, I think.
Mike.
Agreed that sometimes you don't have a lot of time to do some of these initiatives. And so a lot of times you might picture it as you need to get on that right trajectory. You may be the booster rocket that peels off in 3 to 10 years. I'm not sure, Calvin, how long you might, but just to get on that right trajectory. Yeah. And so that those that come in behind see that, hey, we're already on this current path. We're on a great path. Let's not disrupt too much here. And they can see the successes that are coming as a result of being on that path. And so I think as long as you've got that that vision that you can hand down to the organization, the whole organization will not change if the CIO changes, but you still have that effort behind you. And so as long as you can share that vision with everyone and they can capture where you really want to go, then I think that really helped, that even though a transition may happen after maybe even Calvin's gone.
Dewan, you clearly were looking at that as it relates to the way that you were working at the agency heads.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I agree totally. And I think, I purposely did just last, so we're in full year through our first, what we're calling a next level plan. So, we're always jumping on what our governor's doing. So our governor in Indiana, it's all about next level Indiana. And so, hey, now we have a next level technology organization too, and we put in place really a bold agenda on where we need to be for the IT agency of the future for the state. And we've created some core visions for that we've been just repeating. We got them up on screens on our floor, and I keep little cards in my wallet, and I make sure that when I meet with these agency leaders, the governor's office, especially the legislature, when I have my opportunities to meet with them, just to share that. I was like, hey, by the way, here's a new vision we've put in here at our agency. Here's what we're driving to. Here's what we're changing to mold to be that agency of the future. And I think when you can share, hey, I'm really thinking about this strategically, we have a plan here, here's what we're driving towards, and we're not just here keeping the lights on every day. You get a different level, you get a different viewpoint, and you're viewed a little different. Hey, you know, these folks do have a plan for how they're going to make our state better. Here's where they're going, and that kind of sets you up for that long term.
Well, and I think that what I think is really terrific about that as well is we're seeing CIOs make that transition. Right? I mean, even in the case where maybe the political parties changed, even when the governor's turned over, you know, we're seeing several CIOs in the audience that, you know, are actually moving in across administration. But let me just, Josh, ask you maybe to speak to what Bob Sampson talked about, because Bob was very much around that unifying vision. What kind of vision, you know, how do you actually communicate that? Maybe you could relate kind of what Bob was saying.
If Bob was here right now, I don't mean to speak on his behalf, he'd be getting up and high-fiving Duane for what he was just saying. Bob's comments to us were all around this unifying vision. And he uses the phrase institutionalizing the vision. And so I think about the relentless approach that you had in your example of consistently putting that message out there, creating the visuals, creating the talking points, incorporating that as a part of your daily messaging to your troops, and then to make sure that you're hearing that back. So I think Bob would be thrilled to know that that drumbeat goes on, because as he says also, sometimes you just have to push ahead. You know, it's difficult at times to build this coalition of the willing. It's difficult to build teams that are completely and unanimously in an alignment with each other. But moving forward, you've got to find the key touch points that each can rally around and say, okay, I can buy into that piece. Mm-hmm. And if I can buy into that piece, and if you'll stick with me on this piece, then maybe together we can figure out how these next two things connect. So that's where he'd be doing a push-up or a heads-up.
And I think the one thing that's interesting about that is that, you know, for our technology partners in the room, we always talk about read my strategic plan before you come to see me, you know, read it. But I think there's another piece of it that maybe we don't talk about as much to them, which is we have to get that strategic planning message, we have to get that vision out to our folks, right? So that when we have conversations, you're not kind of dependent on, well, if you talk to the CTO, he's got a different view of what we're doing versus what, you know, some of my other folks do. And that's kind of some of the inside baseball that we tell you guys to read the strategic plan, but sometimes we may not be as good at getting it out internally
as
we need
to. That's something you can triangulate. That's something you can test, right? You can reach out to members of your team that you have personal relationship with, say, how is this resonating? Is this resonating with you? Do you feel that it's resonating with the team? You can have those conversations with your partners as well, right? To say, here's what we're saying. I think that we're aligned. Are we? And if we're not, then where are we falling short? I mean, having those key trusted conversations where you triangulate whether the message is on point, whether the message is becoming, or the vision is becoming unified, it's important to triangulate. Otherwise, you're using one person's opinion as to whether or not you're hitting the mark.
I tried this funky thing, which but quite frankly didn't work. I actually tried to do like a book report, right? So I said to my direct reports, you guys got to read our strategic plan that we wrote, and I'm going to ask you questions about it. Never worked. But, you know, it's kind of an interesting concept to try to see whether even my own staff, was actually looking at the plan. Well, let's go to the next audience response question, because we want to be sure that we're relating this back to the broker concept.
Right.
And so what we'd like the audience to do is to say, you know, in the world of the state CIO's broker, which we just talked about,
Which of these traits do you think is most important? I mean, which of these traits do you think is going to really lead to success in this new broker role?
3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Yeah, right. We need music.
We're going to the moon.
That's right.
All right.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, that's what I think.
A vision.
So. Yeah.
Interesting. Interesting. Mm-hmm. I would have thought maybe it might have been around the integrative skills. So that's a little bit different than what I maybe had anticipated. So, Mike, let me go to you. I mean, in this new role, what do you think? I mean, which one of these would you have picked?
Admittedly, I still like relentless curiosity, but I think the audience is right. I think the audience is right that as your role as a broker of services, you need to create that unifying vision and figure out, okay, what do we do next? How do we engage what's out in the marketplace? Otherwise, there's so much available in the marketplace, you may get a little too fragmented.
Agreed.
And so if you have that unifying vision and everybody says, oh, this is where we're going, then at least everybody knows the direction in the marketplace that you might be looking. And so I think the audience is probably right, as much as it pains me to say that it's not relentless curiosity, but I think unifying vision would be spot on.
One thing to consider, right? I think you're absolutely right as well, that is the leader's role, is to create that vision. But one thing to consider is, as you structure in whatever construct you have for your execco, right, for your key leadership team, that these traits ought to be hopefully represented within that execco. So you may not have this relentless curiosity that Mike up here has, but I think that you ought to make sure that one of the key members of your leadership team is constantly pushing the envelope and bringing in something that they're bringing in. Right. I mean, Dave's on your team, and another guy with the great curiosity, relentless in that area. Right. Always asking about the next thing.
Always helps.
So even if one of these areas isn't a particular strong trait in your own personal portfolio, I would recommend ensuring that you've got that covered somewhere in the team that you built.
But that's a great lead-in. So, Duane, let me just ask you around that question. You know, you have key leaders, you know, your key folks that you depend on for in certain areas, and you know, they may be direct reports to you, they may be someplace else in the organization. So as you think about these traits and the political savvy trait that you talked about, how do you work with your team to help them start to develop some of those same capabilities?
It's several ways, you know, and around the unifying vision, the integrative skills. I think one with that, I try to train and educate on more often with that team is that somewhere in between that, and I'll call it inclusion, making sure my team is including the rest of the state and the things they're trying to do, because largely they make a lot of the day-to-day tactical, technical decisions that have wide impact across the board, and I trust them a lot. They're smart folks, but they don't always include the proper folks across the state, and then I get that blowback, and I get those texts and those calls from something they've done, which isn't a good thing. And so a lot of my leadership and direction on that is like, be inclusive on these things. We have a kind of a monthly IT CIO directors meetings that we have, and traditionally before that it was just, hey, we're bringing them in, let's let them talk, get to know one another, and just established from some camaraderie. And then more recently though, I've modified that, and I've assigned key individuals in my organizations to give updates in those, whether it's, you know, and it could be 6 months, 10 months down the road, but start talking about these things and give these folks an opportunity to give feedback and present challenges and help walk them through that and give them the opportunity to let you put yourself in their shoes. I think lots of times we forget that we do these things and we just think the agency IT folks being difficult, but really they're, and we kind of put them in between a rock and a hard place. They got a business leader here that's pushing them, saying, what's going on here? I need this, this isn't working. And they're coming to me or coming to us, and we're saying, sorry, that's the way it's got to be. And they're like, well, what do I do? It's a lose-lose situation. And so trying to work through those more ahead of time and educate them, bring them along, and make them feel part of where we're going.
I think, Josh, that was a part of what Morgan Reed, who wasn't able to join us, really talked about when he talked about integrative and actually being able to bring others into the organization.
Exactly.
Maybe you can talk a little bit about what
Let me
you
throw
know,
one
Morgan's
of Morgan's thoughts
was.
Up here. Good friend. Morgan, one of the things he said is, don't make the mistake of assuming alignment. You may even be in a room where all the heads are nodding, and you may say, great, we're aligned, and go to your next discussion assuming that you've got complete agreement. Just because a person's head is nodding doesn't necessarily mean that they're aligned with your vision. And so I think one of the things that he would recommend doing is taking the time individually. So you may have be in the process of, and I believe he used the term developing a coalition of the willing or a coalition of the aligned. And that may happen in a public setting, but then individual touch points with the members of that group that you need to in the boat with you to move forward ought to be a connection and ought to be a priority for you to reach out. To assume alignment, even when you're getting some visuals or even some audibles, might not be the best thing to do, especially in the earliest stages. So as you achieve that alignment moving forward, then it might be easier to make minor modifications along the way. So I thought it was wonderful, because I quite often will make the mistake of assuming that just because I said something and somebody acknowledged what I said, that we're somehow on the same page, when that might not always be the case.
Well, somebody once told me that if you're in a session and everybody nods, very often that means I heard you. That yeah. doesn't necessarily mean I agree.
Right. Right.
You know,
right.
And I think we do make that mistake.
And I love the idea of creating an environment where some debate is welcome, right?
Yeah.
So that you don't necessarily look for just complicit approval across the board,
yeah.
but that good ideas and better ideas are welcome.
Well, actually, that might be.
I disagree.
Be, yeah.
You disagree?
No, I'm just kidding.
Actually, that might be a good way to know if you've had a good meeting. If everybody agrees and
yeah.
then walks out, maybe you didn't
yeah.
have the meeting you
right.
thought you
Did
were.
Did you push it as far as you could?
Yeah.
Right, right.
You know, Craig, I mean, you're in a challenging environment in terms of being able to be integrative. You've got how many ever agencies and folks weighing in.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some of the things that you've seen in terms of trying to bring people along and, you know, to Dewan's point, also helping your folks understand
sure.
how to work in your challenging environment?
Yeah, and under the trait that we talked about, I mutual respect,
mm-hmm.
and collegiality, you know, which, and I'm not about to step on a soapbox, but in today's environment, those are actually, you know, skills that I think are traits that are just exceedingly valuable. You know, I think there's a lot of mudslinging and rock chunking. That's what we call it in Mississippi. But in all truthfulness, I think mutual respect, which I think it has come out in other elements of the panel, is one of the key ways. If you really let that person know, I mean, I you know, respect what you do. We have a technical guy at our agency that's really brilliant. You know, he's a very smart guy. And one of the things we say is that he probably can't run the agency, and the agency can't run without him.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that is a very simple way to say we're all important. We're all, you know, there's,
right.
and so whether it's, you know, to Morgan's stuff, you know, integrating the team or build that coalition, it's mutual respect, ultimately, I think, which I think comes directly out of a self-awareness of
right.
where
well,
you
yeah.
are, what your junk is that you're bringing to whatever meeting you're in, whatever issues you have, and then, you know, negotiating from there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I want to also bring out, Josh, everyone here, all the five CIOs that worked with us
yeah.
were good enough to share books.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
I think Craig talked about it. So maybe you could just mention that to the
yeah,
audience
no,
so they know
gonna,
how
I
to get
definitely
there.
Definitely mention that. So, so by the way, if you haven't picked it up, we actually wrote a paper on this topic, and it's online, and I'm sure that we can work with Doug and the team to provide a link to
right.
be able to review that paper. As a part of the interviews that we conducted, obviously these are very well-read gentlemen, and they started to quote in some cases some books that they had read from. So we thought it would be interesting to create a bibliography, so to speak, and attached to the article is a list of the books that you all recommended to us
to become a little bit more savvy in some of these topic areas. It spanned the gambit, but a lot of it did talk about this next level of leadership, this next level of integration skills as leaders. And the other, I picked up one or two of them. The other thing that I really honed in on was, again, this idea that you're asked in many cases to lead without an army, or to make improvement without necessarily the funding or resources to do that. To create innovation, that first you need to require, or that you need to build consensus around. And that's a difficult place to be. So the skill sets that we're talking about here help you operate in that space a little bit, which I thought was brilliant. These are, I think, phenomenal books. So take a look at the list. I'm sure you've probably read some of them. I'm sure many of the titles will be familiar to you, but there might be one or two that you haven't seen.
Great. All right, well, I would like to take our last few minutes to talk about which trait you'd like to get better at. Actually, we'll start with Josh, and I know his is that he has to be a little more outgoing and a little bit more outspoken, and you know, be willing to kind of put himself out there to the crowd.
But he's clearly introverted.
Absolutely. But Josh, we'll start with you. So
sure.
Which of the traits would do you feel are ones that you need to think about
I'm going with what Bob Sampson said around unifying vision. I feel that we quite often slip into the misstep of assuming unified vision. I know that I do that. And so the idea that we can maybe put a message out there, it's almost an agile approach to creating consensus. You put it out there and then you test it a little bit. You have some individual conversations and then you maybe modify where you think you stand in the spectrum of how unified is this group really, and then make the adjustments. That's one where I think I need to work on.
Okay, Dwan.
Well, I think I need to improve in all of them, but I think, you know, the political savvy for me is a not-ending journey. It's a never-ending journey. I'm always working on that, and I think one area in there in particular is just being stronger on my business acumen and learning that particular language. You know, governors and legislatures and folks really respond to strong business cases, and that can usually get you out of this whole debate of technology and people and everything if you can just get down to brass tacks and talk business. And so that's what I'm continuing to try to get better at, and I would encourage you know, in this area I've actually sought out a mentor that I respect, that I know has that business background and that can speak that language, and that can push back on me on certain conversations, and he's offered to meet with me regularly and kind of coach me on these things. And so that's what I'm, that's on my list to continue to grow at.
I have to agree with Josh, unifying vision. A lot of times you feel like you know where you want to go, but it doesn't permeate the agency. And so you get these things thrown in the road. Wait, I thought everybody knew we were going this way. And all of a sudden you think, wait, what are you doing over here? Yeah. So I think to be able to communicate that vision that you have, so the whole agency and the whole enterprise is on board, so that as you get other agencies coming to you, they know right beforehand, they know the answer. Yeah. So it really makes some of these things that Dewan's talking about a little more, you know, easier discussions, that kind of thing. But I think unifying vision is something I need to focus on going forward.
Yeah, I think, Mike, it's an interesting phenomenon, because I've experienced that too. When you are someone with sort of your relentless curiosity, you got your stuff going a mile a minute. Yeah. And I know I used to say to myself, you know, this stuff doesn't get out of my office through osmosis. It doesn't sort of seep through the walls. You know, you've got to be able to articulate and be able to talk about it. I get that part. Craig.
I think curiosity for me, oddly enough. I know my reading list in the back was a little wild. But what I mean, I've been thinking about it. What I mean by that is I think you can get, I think Dean talked about it on the panel. You can get so heads down that you sort of push that part of it aside. And I think great organizations, Mike epitomizes it, they're curious. And so that was really the way I came at that one of, you know, you're just all about every day. We're all operational people in essence, delivering, however it gets delivered. But then I think you have to be just cautious that you don't take the curiosity out of the job, which is also another way of saying make sure there's fun in there too.
Absolutely. So I think sometimes important. you know, like you say, we get so caught up that we say, well, I'm going to be curious after I get through this latest crisis.
Well, the idea of looking up from the visor is, right. I think, spot on.
Right, yeah. Right. Well, let's all please thank everyone on the panel for talking
job,
about
guys.
What's important
Bravo.
To them.
Nice job, Craig. Yeah, to you.
And hopefully this gave you an opportunity to get to know them better, and maybe through their insights, get, as Craig said, get some self-awareness and be thinking about those kinds of things that are important to you
maybe
as well.
Maybe over a drink tonight, you can ask Terry what things she's working on.
All right, well, thanks.
Thanks you,
very much.
Thank you
guys.
Thank you
very
guys.
Much, so much. Thanks, Terry. Wow. That was incredibly relevant. A little bit of an informal poll here. Who found themselves, show of hands, who found themselves really relating to what you just heard up here? Yeah, lots of hands. Given that, let's have one more vigorous round of applause for this awesome panel. You know, something Dewan said gave me an idea for a stretch goal for myself. Imagine if the agency heads would buy me lunch. How awesome would that be? All right, folks, we've got a little announcement to make. We're about to take a 30-minute break so the hotel staff can set up the room for lunch, so we'll be back here at noon. But I want to ask at this point, all of you folks who have your NASIO socks on, please gather at the stage right now for a photo op. Anyone with NASIO socks, come on down.